Welcome to the Reimagine Podcast.
Welcome to
Each
the Reimagine
Podcast.
Give yourself 30
Each
minutes
week,
and meet
the
people
working
30
hard
minutes
to create
and meet
the future
of
working
insurance
hard
today.
To create the future of insurance today.
Hi, this is Paul Tyler, and this summer, NASA Reimagine hosted the first annual Retire Tech Forum. And Laura, who came?
We had over 100 attendees representing industry decision makers, insurtechs, fintechs, and retire tech startups that joined us not only in Hartford, Connecticut, but also virtually. So it was very exciting to see the group of individuals together.
You know, it was indeed. And you organized, was it six panel discussions?
Six.
With over 25 speakers. That's right. They took the stage at the forum and explored a number of very interesting issues, including sales and marketing, service and operations, product innovation, risk management, climate risk, and core advisor software. And so today we're sharing session two, service and operations. We call this moving service functions from the call center to the app store. Laura, tell us more.
Yeah, we had some great speakers from Inovio, Socotra, Infosys, AmeriLife, and Ben Akiva. And one of the things that stood out was Bobby from Ben Akiva was talking about generation and age. And we talked about age being something that might help us define retirement. But really, no matter what age somebody is as a consumer, they want to just care about how easy is this process going to be for them and just making it about a seamless claim and service perspective and doing things simply. And I think that's something that we need to keep in mind here in the industry.
Yeah, and doing something simple in this business is actually one of the hardest things to do here. And, you know, we've heard omnichannel used so much, Laura, right, that I think we could almost make a bingo game out of it. That said, I think in the last couple of years, you know, consumers' expectations that you'd have to label omnichannel have just exploded. They want to go to a website, they want to chat, they then want to text, they want to have a Zoom call, they want to have a phone call, and then maybe they'll buy or they'll meet you. And this is just putting incredible stress and created a lot of opportunities for startups in the space to, as you said, make it feel simple to the customer. So, I don't know. Laura, roll the tape.
I wanted to bring up the rest of our panelists as well. Right. Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to session two for service and operations. I'm honored to be moderating this panel of very talented experts from many different subject areas within the topic. So I'm really excited for the conversation. I'll give everyone a chance to introduce themselves, but I'll go ahead and kick it off. My name is Zainab Nurali. I am the head of innovation and thought leadership at Infosys's Retirement Center of Excellence. I've been in the retirement industries, particularly in the DC space, for the last 15 years. Started my career at a retirement provider where I focused a lot of my energy on the plan sponsor and participant experience. After that, I joined a very early stage startup company called Vestwell, where we were offering a retirement platform for advisors and for small businesses to give them access to 401k plans as small business owners. Was head of sales and strategy there. And then I joined Deloitte for 5 years, where I was a management consultant in the retirement and wealth space, where I had a lot of great conversations with retirement providers and helping them find solutions for their business use cases and their problems. And I just joined Infosys relatively recently. It's been less than 6 months. So excited to be here and talk about the importance of customer experience. My experience and my 15 years has been really focused on customer experience. So I know the importance of it, particularly how it's evolved over the last few years, you know, pre-pandemic, even during the pandemic, and eventually if we will ever get there post-pandemic, to see how the needs of our stakeholders have changed. But wanted to pass it off to Bobby and give her introduction as well.
Good afternoon, everyone. Bobby Srivastav. I'm a co-founder, chief product officer of Benikiva. And what Benikiva is a claims and servicing platform. We focused on building our solution from a beneficiary-first perspective when it comes to claims. And also, how do we make it easy for the staff to manage and adjudicate the entire claims value chain? And prior to Benikiva, Benikiva is my third SaaS startup. I worked for organizations such as Pepsi, Division of AIG, and Center for Creative Leadership. And I'm looking forward to being part of the panel to talk about some insights.
So we're going to share a mic. Hi, my name is Manisha Bhargav. I'm the Chief Customer Officer of Innoveo. Innoveo is a no-code platform company which solves for complex insurance-centric business problems in a very agile and rapid way. I have a career in technology and business. I've essentially worked with clients across the globe, right from Asia, Europe, and North America, as well as the LATAM, South American markets, in their transformation journeys. What I could bring to the conversation is a rich understanding of what is driving change across markets. I definitely see a lot of change coming in from, I think the way insurers are transforming themselves across markets is interesting. If you look at what Asia is doing, what the LATAM market is doing, where there are a bunch, I think they're far larger population of people to address, a lot of underserved economies, as well as when you look at more mature markets, the way technology is transforming client experiences. I come in with that lens and happy to share some of that with you. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Pete Sanderson. I work at Socotra as an account manager. Socotra is a cloud native platform that's built for policy administration. At Socotra, we do everything from quote to claim and everything in between. Our focus is on P&C. We do some life products, like simple term life products, and then we're doing some med sup as well with a large carrier. So in previous lives, I've worked as a marketer. I helped some folks launch and sell an MGA that focused on Medicare and med sup in Rhode Island and New England area. And that's probably where I'm coming in on this panel. So I did a lot. I'm the guy that sent a ton of mail and a ton of emails and got a lot of leads in for reps. We serviced a lot of people, and that product got sold and is still doing very well today.
Hello, everyone. My name is Galia Appel. I'm Senior Vice President of Strategy and Innovation at AmeriLife. It's really hard to represent innovation at a distributor where you actually have people from real innovative companies here. But we do our best. So as you know, AmeriLife has been on a journey of attracting money from reputable investors for several years now. We just raised another fund from Genstar, which tries to bring innovation in a lot of platform plays around the country. And in my role, I oversee a lot of elements of how we call it value proposition, right? If you are a distributor and a wholesaler, you basically touch every single link of the value chain from carrier to the FMO, to IMO, agency, agent, and ultimately the consumer. And so we are constantly trying to reimagine sort of what the value we can bring as a platform player. It's been a very interesting time for me. I've been with AmeriLife for 2 years. And before that, I spent 10 years at Boston Consulting Group doing transformational consulting for financial institutions and did a lot of work in customer-centric transformations, which was an interesting journey, especially talking about it in 2015, when I think in financial sector back then, it was still a very, very weird concept. They were like, what do you mean customer-centric? And I was like, well, you sell mortgage and a car loan and a credit card out of three different departments, and none of them knows that they do it, what you do in other departments. And they were like, what's the problem? So at least now we moved, you know, a bit away from that. And we do talk a lot about customer journeys and agent journeys and how technology really augments it and helps to facilitate a much better and more enriching experience for everyone in the both sales conversation, but also in services. So I'm very excited to share what we are thinking about at AmeriLife, but also from my consultant background. And let's have a good discussion.
Awesome. Well, let's just jump right in. Just a few years ago, I think our industry was so focused on being tech forward and innovative, particularly to engage the younger population. Because, you know, the seniors, they like their paper statements, they like going to the call center, or they like engaging with an individual face-to-face. But boy, has that changed. I'm sure many of us in this room saw this evolve, especially in the last couple of years. My family in particular, right? I was, for some reason, all of a sudden, overnight, my entire family knew what Zoom was. It's no longer a company, you know, teleconferencing platform. My family was using it to be in touch during the pandemic, and they all had it downloaded on their iPads, their iPhones, their laptops. All of a sudden, my mom's asking me, how do you use Venmo and Zelle? And I'm like, why do you even know what that is? So it was a really interesting shift to see the seniors starting to be a little bit more tech savvy and more engaged digitally than they were before. And they were almost forced by it. And they adopted just as seamlessly as the younger population, right? It wasn't that hard for them to pick it up and get comfortable with it. And to add to this shift, there's almost 10,000 baby boomers that are turning 65 every single day. In 2031, in fact, the US population over the age of 65 will be 75 million, which is double what it was just 15 or 20 years ago. So with this generational shift and the size that's transitioning out of the workforce, it's obviously going to impact retirement providers. So what I wanted to ask the panelists is, now that the baby boomers are and seniors are becoming more and more comfortable with technology, how will this change how they want to engage with their service providers? And how will carriers and agents need to conform to this shift?
Yeah, I can go first. So I think like the trends that we've been seeing in the marketplace with the generational, I think it's the same want and desire that any generation has, which is meet me where I'm at. Give me the most easiest way to complete a task. Because honestly, as a consumer, whether regardless of the age demographic, you don't really care about what the carrier internal process is when it comes to services. You don't care that they have 10 to 20 different legacy systems. All you care about from a claim and servicing perspective is, I need to file a claim. What's next? What do you need to require? And how do I interact with you? Whether if I'm a senior that is still not gravitating towards digital, whether that's traditional mechanisms, or whether I want to be digital first. So I think from a carrier lens in this scenario, as a service provider, is how do you look at meeting your user base where they're at and giving them all the things that we want from a consumer perspective is how do I make it easy for them to complete a task? How do I, when I call in, we were talking about in the earlier panel, how do they know that I'm the person that's calling? How do I validate easily? How do I submit information to you without having the need to fax, do the same fillable PDF that doesn't really, I'm going to have NIGO off the door internally. So it's all about the reducing the friction, but it's also appreciating the user and what their desires are, because we can't go digital for digital's sake. It's really meeting about their needs, whether they're a younger consumer or an older consumer, whether they want digital or traditional.
So irrespective, and I echo Bobby's point about looking at the consumer in a holistic sense. Even if you look at the 50 plus consumer, engaging with any aspect of their lives, whether it is retirement planning, whether it is just getting groceries, whether it is engaging with their financial organizations. They've adopted digital in a big way. However, servicing is the center of it. It's not consumption, it is servicing. And while a lot of the industry is looking at how do I get my EF out there, how can I start selling more, how do I enable the agent, what's going to be material is completing that life cycle, delivering a straight through experience across the value chain, integrating with those legacies, and delivering service at the heart of it, the sale will happen. So it's all about shifting the focus, at least I believe. How can you service it at the center of the client experience and the client service moment? That is going to be the shift in thinking that we need to be thinking of.
Yeah, I think in terms of listening to you guys, I think in terms of what we used to call personas in marketing. So as you were talking, I'm like, okay, there's Peter Print and there's Doris Digital or something like that. You know, so you almost immediately have two different types of client that you're working for, and how you service each of those is going to be different. Obviously, everybody wants to treat folks digitally because it's in theory easier. But at the end of the day, you're going to have to service some of those older folks the way that they're used to, which is a little bit more maybe print oriented or maybe a greater touch.
So I guess it's, clarify, it's not about, it has to be both.
Yeah.
It's not one or the other, right? It's both.
Yes,
it's about how you're enabling that transaction piece. However, having the, the previous panel was very interesting because I echoed with a lot of the thoughts that were spoken there. It's all about marrying the agent or the advisor along with the digital experience.
So I guess my perspective here will sort of tap into what you just said, because AmeriLife, when we think about our client is primarily the agent who then serves the person who is seeking the advice or product. And the very interesting observation we made in the last year or so, when all the consumers were already mentally prepared to embrace the digital innovation, a lot of agents were not. And so what we're observing actually is that in agent community, which we all know is, you know, aging rapidly, it's sort of the average age in the industry is 56, 57. And obviously they are not necessarily on the front of the digital revolution. And for them, adoption of tools was even more complex. And part of the reason for that is, which we're reflecting on, there are actually no tools that represent independent agent viewpoint. Like there are tons of tools that sort of solve for very particular activities within their workday, but none of it that represents a full sort of blown CRM / book of business management tool. Because I guess, it's a little bit industry specific until, companies like AmeriLife started to emerge and represent hundreds of thousands of independent agents. Like there was just no representation and demand for solutions like this. And so we're actually living through very interesting times where even though consumers are ready, agents very often are not. And it's really hard for them because, we have interviews with agents and they say, I can run my book of business with a notepad and a pen. Why do you give me an iPad? Why do you give me, all these e-apps? Like, I don't like that. It's not how I do my business. Like, I drive around in my car. I don't need an iPad somewhere there, like on the next seat. So it's interesting how we need to actually influence the main channel to adopt this and educate them about how technology can positively augment their sales effectiveness and the service effectiveness. And it's interesting to see that we also have a new generation of agents, and they're probably more prominent in Medicare and final expense, where more transactional products. But there you see like 27-year-olds going and successfully being able to service people, because they do actually embrace the technology and they do embrace, you know, meeting people on Facebook or in other social media channels, and they understand what drip email campaign is and what building personal brand on YouTube and community on Facebook means. And that actually allows them to sort of educate the consumers also about what's the new experience, right? All of a sudden, like, you can have a real digital community experience about, you know, things like Medicare. And we didn't have that 2-3 years ago. So it's very interesting to see. But I think we actually have quite a lot of resistance in the system that we need to overcome. And I think that one of the interesting aspects to think about is, I like the narrative of simplicity. And I think that we need to think about tools being super simple for agents as well. And it's not degrading at all to make, you know, the tool as simple as possible. We sometimes think, okay, if someone, you know, needs to drive a plane or, like, you know, drive a car, it has to be a super complex dashboard with a lot of different, you know, tools and metrics. No, because it's overwhelming. And we actually don't want them to be overwhelmed. We want them to embrace the very new experience. So
one comment, your spark about the agent really brought back the story about our first customer. So our first customer was a pre-need customer where the claimant is also the agent because it's an assigned beneficiary. And when we were building our product initially, we were building it, of course, insurtech. We're going to be digital, you know, digital first. And the audience is the funeral home. And we learned that 80% of the claims that were coming in were through faxes. And I was like, oh yeah, I'm one of those people that want to get rid of the fax machine, like the office space. Like, I want to hammer down the faxes, get rid of that. But I had to quickly learn that I can't do that in order to be successful, because 80%, in order to create that change, I had to meet that agent, that claimant where they're at. So I had to accept faxes. But what we learned through that process was, if we enable digital and traditional mechanism and showed the path of digital is a slightly little better process, you're going to get faster notification, we're going to get that readability correct, they're going to slowly move to more digital avenues. But we have to start with the persona in mind and build it backwards instead of really forcing digital.
The digital agent thing was interesting. I was thinking back. Our biggest question was, what's my password, from an agent standpoint? And I don't mean that that's kind of snide and all that, but it's true. It's like the guys who we were, and the folks we were working with were 56 plus, somewhere in there. They crushed it. They did a lot of work. But
And then you ask them in the survey, are you a digitally savvy person? And everyone says yes. Yeah. So it's interesting. Like, I feel like our industry as a whole will benefit from some kind of mass collectively sponsored ethnography study of agents, because we have a lot of assumptions about that community, but I think that the reality might be eye-opening.
Yeah, and I think the shift doesn't necessarily mean we have to go 100% digital, right? I think there is that happy medium, that hybrid approach that we're talking about, where there's going to be situations like password resets and account information that IVRs and chatbots can completely replace humans to be able to do. But then there's going to, like myself, when I'm in a particular situation with whether it's a credit card company or my bank or whatever, I do want to pick up the phone and talk to somebody because I know I'm not going to find that in the FAQs. I'm not going to find the answer in the website. But I easily want, if I'm ready to take action, then I want to go back on the online channel and take action online and be able to track where the progress of my transaction online as well. So it's going to be very important to find that that happy medium where it's going to be easy for the end user, whether it's the agent, the consumer, to be jumping back and forth between these channels, because that's going to be our future for the next several years until, if we even go 100% digital. I don't think it'll ever even make sense to go. You'll always need that human connection at some point in the journey.
It finally boils down to how many, I mean, from the pool of transactions, what percentage of those transactions need that human touch and what can be eliminated, thereby driving efficiency in that system and also driving adoption in the process, including, you know, when you're for simple transactions, you do not need a face-to-face. And How many of our parents and grandparents started using Instacart during the pandemic, right? If we look at the number of people who adopted and embraced digital channels, it kind of it took out a lot of that conservatism in the equation during the pandemic. So we can, at this juncture, start from a space of saying digitalization has been embraced in a lot of ways across different spectrums of life. So there is acceptance. And when we start from that space and then start eliminating those, those anxiety moments where you do need a human touch. But beyond that, it's all about the digital experience at a transactional level. I think the way we reimagine that will probably drive a better strategy.
I really like what you said, because what we see in our research is that in every customer journey, right, there is a moment where there is a utmost need for validation, right? And for example, for financial products, a lot is just the product selection, right? So you kind of understand what benefits you want. You understand what you're ready to pay. And then, you know, when you sort of in all the different comparison tools, you type all these things in and you see 10 different products that kind of, you know, fit your profile. And at that point, you need someone to sort of navigate you around the choices. But ultimately, you know, typing in your needs, if the intake form is intuitive enough, or, you know, thinking about like this or that, like it's almost like we need to understand where the agent or advisor is absolutely necessary and which parts, you know, we can actually enable the person to complete themselves. And it's the same with the agent, by the way, right? So when agent submits the business, like, you know, they also like some things they can do themselves, but at some point, someone from the carrier side also needs to help them. And at some point when because we talk about services, I would love to also talk a little bit about the fact that in our industry, one of the reasons why we're a little bit behind, P&C or wealth management is because the product manufacturers, i.e. carriers, and I apologize, you know, being in the building of one, but they don't make it easy to automate everything related to the products because the data is actually not very easily accessible. And so I think that a lot of us here, you know, are struggling to also create those experiences because to power those experiences, we need, you know, policy status and try to integrate the feed with policy status from a given carrier. Not saying this one, but like, you know, just a given carrier. And it's probably 6 months of custom integration. Like, and if you're trying to sell products from multiple carriers, you know, multiply it times carriers times products, and then who has time for 25 years of endless integrations, right? So I think that we're probably also waiting for some kind of standardization of data across different policy parameters, right? So that we have some kind of policy status API, you know, like commission API, something else API that we can actually channel this data in the most effective way.
I definitely want to get into like the product feature side of things of how we can enable the digital journey. But taking it back to the importance of that relationship, right, where I think we can all agree in this room that especially for major financial decisions, people want to talk to a financial professional before making that major decision. We brought it up in the last panel as well. It's very important. And I think the underlying reason for that is trust, right? There's either a financial advisor, there's a financial professional, there's somebody within your family or your own network that you're trusting to help you make that decision. So how can we be building that trust in a digital journey?
Yeah, I can. We're so much focused on the claims side of the house. And oftentimes what we've seen for most traditional carriers is at the time of claim, if a claimant is a family member, they may or may not be looping in the agent of the person that's just passed away. And the battle from the field perspective is typically, you know, I've serviced this family for so long, but at the time of when it's needed the most, How come I have not been aware? And from a tech perspective, that's as simple as notification. And I get the legacy landscape, not trying to oversimplify. That's a different topic we can talk about. But from a trust perspective at the time of claim, what we've seen in our research is if you loop in the advisor as part of the claim process and make it easy, even as easy of getting the agent the tools, because in some carrier scenarios that have an agency pool, 50% of the claims are coming from family and other mechanisms, and 50% of the claims are coming through the advisors. And their biggest complaint to the carrier is, you're making me go through the same process as somebody, as a claimant, but I'm part of your system. I'm part of your organization. Make my life easy. So it's just as simple as creating those tools and looking at that persona and building that claim journey that they can serve the claimant at the time of need. And what we've seen in our research is like less than 4% of claims when they get paid, it gets retained back to the carrier. And we have a, in our research, it shows that percentage gets increased if you loop in the advisor because it's a trusted individual. And it gives that care, it gives that agent the opportunity to sell more services of the carrier. So it's, you know, we focus so much in our industry about distribution or lapse issues, but oftentimes we forget about the claim payments going out and that retention. And that retention, in our belief, is when there's a human involved.
I think the single largest way of delivering trust in a digital channel is transparency and visibility. These are the two, and visibility and transparency from the perspective, whether it is the customer having the visibility and transparency on the offers available to them at the point of sale, the transparency and visibility of what's happening to the claim across the life cycle, the availability of information, so the visibility and transparency for the advisor and agent in as they engage with the customer, as well as the carrier engages with the customer. So whether it's that notification, whether it is at the point of sale, the visibility and transparency of commissions that they're earning as a part of the process. So I think when we start solving for that, along with doing that simply, that builds trust more than anything else.
I like that. And I also like the concept of, you know, how trust is and loyalty is something that sort of result of consistent positive experience, right? And I think that connecting to the topic that was discussed on the previous panel, you know, experiences, sort of expectations minus reality. And I think with a lot of investments in digital fronts, we create very high expectations and then consistently mismatch it with reality. And that's where sort of the trust gets eroded very, very quickly. And I think when we were preparing for the panel, we actually were talking that, you know, so carriers now obviously try to understand how in the disintermediated space sort of create the brand recognition and loyalty. And a lot of them kind of keep forgetting that the only experience that customer actually has, it's not at the point of acquisition, it's a point of claim. And it doesn't matter how beautiful your brand, you know, looks like when you display it during the Super Bowl commercial, if you know of someone who had to go through death claim and had a horrible experience. And so it's very interesting to sort of think about how investments are made. And by the way, like, you know, we have the same thing. You know, it's very easy to invest in something that generates revenue and very hard to invest in something that generates retention or satisfaction, because it's very hard to, you know, append some kind of business metrics to it. But I think Now in Medicare, for example, where the retention on the policy, you know, becomes like a very, very big criteria of success for everyone involved, it kind of, you know, shifts a little bit. But I feel like in sort of one lifetime purchases, like a lot of life products or annuity products, we probably struggle to put the focus on the experience.
And I think there's a lot of technology and tools out there that can help enable this too, right? So how do you get that human experience in technology? I don't think we'll ever be able to replace humans 100%, but we can get pretty darn close. You know, there's a tool that Infosys uses called Cortex, and I'm thinking about this because I just had a meeting about it, but they that tool basically nudges contact center reps or even gives the data to the chatbot to be able to pick up on consumer sentiment, right? So they're picking up on what phrases or what responses are getting consumers annoyed or frustrated or upset. That way they can continue to refine the experience to build that connection, right? So instead of, and I'm the first to do this, when I get, if my call is received by an IVR, I immediately start going agent. I don't even want to go through that experience. But if I find that the IVR is almost talking like a human and asking me like, you know, how can it, like almost like having a conversation versus a robot, I'd be a little bit more open to it. And I would start building a little bit more trust in that system and allowing a robot to talk to me versus wanting to talk to a human. So I think we're getting close to being able to replace a human, but I don't think we'll fully be able to, like there's going to be always that scenario or that circumstance where you're just going to be like, I need to talk to somebody.
It's tricky because people trust people, not always technology right now. So we, when we were doing our Medicare work, we found a lot of people would come to us, you know, a few years later and ask us for, you know, financial advice. And we're like, oh, wait a second. But that quickly turned, we vetted and found a partner, and we ended up kind of creating a side business on that where it was great for us. It was great for the customer. They had that agent that they've been working with all along. We could have probably gotten better at identifying triggers to like when certain people were more ready than not to do what they needed to do. But it's hard to fully replace just the connection that you have with another human being.
So let's look at financial services as a case study, right? That industry is engaging with all aspects, all age groups, and delivering services, delivering products, delivering complex products digitally. And it's the same consumer where they're getting an experience from a financial services organization of being, including wealth products and, portfolio management digitally. And here is that same customer who's experiencing consumption of life products, retirement products, from life insurers or from, the healthcare world differently. So it's not the consumer that has to adapt or is preferring advisory services. It's about how are you delivering that information and service to the customer for them to be able to consume. And I think we really have to start looking differently rather than trying to solve for the fact with the assumption that the customer always needs an advisor in the mix. Maybe not. Mm.
It's about meeting the customer where they're at. So in that scenario where you were talking about like the technology really enabled that service. But if in your scenario with the robot, if you were to say agent, and if you didn't have the human, it would have been lost, right? It would have been. So it's like, how do you come up with meeting the consumer needs? And whether that's, you know, they need an advisor, maybe they don't need an advisor, but how do you make that experience where maybe they go through a workflow of what they need from a financial, like I always think about claims, but from a claim perspective, if my claim payout includes, I want a portion of my proceed to fund a different product, if that workflow was clean and I don't need an advisor because it's that journey, I understand it. But at any point, if I need a human to connect with, how do we facilitate, how do we orchestrate that in a seamless manner? How do we allow technology to be a true enabler instead of a replacer?
And fortunately or unfortunately, I mean, the answer for that is let's look at how tech companies do that, right? And the first thing they build is a very powerful customer data platform that underpins every single interaction that they're having with the consumer. And I think that obviously in product-centric environment where the policy is the unit of information, it's really hard to create a customer-anchored data set that, that you can then append all sorts of metadata on and browsing data. And that's, I think, it's an interesting thing because what we see right now in the industry, right? You have on one hand, massive revolution of lead providers. And it's an industry about which we can have a whole separate conversation, probably not here, but you have sort of the you know, personal identifiable record sellers. Then you have the whole layer of people who sell some data you can append to those leads. Then you have everyone who will tell you, I will build a profile of your customer. And then somewhere at the end of it, carriers need to decide how to sell to them, but they actually still don't own the customer. And I think that ultimately, whoever creates that that view, that really informed view of the consumer, will eventually be the most successful in both servicing and selling. And maybe just pointing a little bit to the product innovation, because we're talking about retirement. Like one of the interesting things that I see in this space is right now we have a lot of concepts that sort of reinvent the retirement products to solve for a particular need. Like, for example, at the conference a couple of weeks ago, I talked to guys from Retirement Genius, and what they do, they take a life insurance policy and they find people who are just about to default on their life insurance policy. And then they basically buy that policy from them with a discount and give them money that they can put in like HRA type fund to use to pay for long-term care. Because they figured out, okay, there are these people who like have this very expensive policy, but they're so concerned about their healthcare costs that the life insurance policy doesn't address, that they would like forgo on substantial part of the payout just to be able to afford their healthcare bills. And I think for me, it was an interesting example of the fact that we as the industry sometimes think that, oh, if the person has life insurance policy, they're kind of taken care of. Whereas like a lot of people will benefit from constant reevaluation of their current situation and financial needs, not just like overall retirement, but also day to day. And I think that that creates a lot of opportunities for maybe re-platforming consumer from one product to another, depending on their needs in the moment. And maybe carriers can look into that because we see a lot of sort of this abandoning of the product at a time where like, you know, people put money against that for 15, 20 years, but they have to walk away because they just can't afford it for whatever reason. And it's interesting how the industry kind of doesn't catch that.
You hit on a really, I think, key point that the technology cannot replace an advisor in one particular aspect. And it's where, just exactly what you said, really good clients don't refer to their advisor as a financial advisor, they're their advisor. And the way, you know, life events and advice as it relates to certain kind of dynamics with kids or with grandparents or things like that, that's something that technology can't get into. But where the product manufacturer can get into some of that stuff is some of the dynamics of exactly what you're talking about. Being able to look at other type products.
And I think it's just in general, like thinking of, I mean, we all know that the problem with advisor engagement with retirees is that decumulation of assets is not a particularly lucrative, you know, area for them. They're like, okay, I'm going to put you on annuity and focus on some other yuppies, sorry to say. I think that, you know, we need to figure out the regimen of treatment of the people in that stage that, you know, creates new product opportunities, new discussion opportunities, and just regular engagement.
What's interesting is those are kind of problems that technology is trying to solve for. I'll just call upon a use case that we are delivering in Asia, where we are working in the embedded space. So working with the rideshare companies and the telecom companies in Malaysia and Thailand and Singapore, where we are capturing in the partner or the distributor, and this is a use case for a large carrier, where we are capturing different life moments as a part of their life journey, using those as triggers with AI engines, figuring out simple things. In an e-wallet, the customer starts buying diapers. That means there's a life moment that's happening there. And serving of products, which is saying that, the client may have a new born in their family. How do they start their, the education fund? How do they start preparing for life products? And that's the kind of innovation that's happening, driven by technology, fueled by technology, to be a part of that life cycle. And those are some aspects, I think, as we evolve and more carriers start adopting these kind of use cases, we'll start seeing how advisors, to some extent, can be replaced using technology.
You mentioned something about data, and I came from the publishing industry, so that was an interesting industry in that the moment Amazon kind of came into play, they were sucking out all the data. We didn't get the data back, and we always talked about the single view of the customer, and then all of a sudden, we didn't have any customers. We were selling tons of books, but we didn't have any customers, and that's in order to do a lot of the things you've talked about, you still need the customer. So,
can I make a quick comment? I work predominantly in the healthcare arena. Medicaid is 50% of the market, depending on the state. But there's something more fundamental about digital transformation. That is the digital divide. Not all your customers have an internet connection. And second is digital literacy. You cannot ignore those two factors. Then only can you go to the third one.
Yeah, so that's where a persona would come into play. So. Yeah.
And about sort of the mode of delivery, I think that's something we didn't touch. I hope no one still creates anything for desktop first.
This was fascinating. Thank you so much. SB, just to play off your point, it was very interesting. We found, working with our advisors, suddenly seniors are turning Zoom on. We supported Mark, you were on that one. We did a live event, live stream event with one of our advisors. Suddenly, 20 customers popped up. I mean, I've never seen a customer, to that point, Danny. They were old, older than me. And they were on Zoom. And so we started talking and said, how do they get on here? And, it turned out the help desk were the churches, because a lot of these people, very active in church, and all the churches went online and trained them. So it's, there's been massive amount of change in this particular sector you all have been talking about. First of all, thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for listening. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and recommend us on iTunes, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can also get more great information about this company and other great startups at imagine.nfg.com.